Okay, good morning everyone. Okay, thanks. I think it's a privilege to start day two. So I'm not complaining, the first one got cancelled. Okay, so the topic I was supposed to present here is saying how to implement machine learning models in production. And then when I started to build my PPT and recount my experiences, I thought it sort of became saying how not to implement, saying what are the mistakes that we've made along the way, and what can we learn from there. So I think I'm going to focus on some of the experiences that we have had while implementing machine learning models. In terms of introduction, I think introduction is already covered. So just suffice to say that I've been around a long, long time. I've seen, till 4 or 5 years ago, implementing models that we made was not a big deal because, you're doing logistic regression or some other things, and you could easily get an equation and you give it to some developer and they will implement it. So that, people who are building models were not really involved in implementing those models. They're involved in some of the testing, etc. But all of that sort of started to change a few years ago when there were more and more machine learning models are built. Now, when we build a machine learning model, there's no equation or simple equation that comes out that we can go and implement, then we can go give it to some developer to implement. And I think that's where sort of the game began to change. And now we have come to a stage where a lot of companies are saying, oh, we have solutions, one-click deployment solutions. But I just want to talk through saying how difficult it was in this journey. And even today, I'll talk about my experiences in India and outside India. When we go to implement, what kind of obstacles we may face? Okay. So first of all, I can skip this. This is what we do. I think already covered. So what we're going to cover is implementation basics. So I'll just talk about some common terms so that we are on the same page. And we're going to talk about saying what can go wrong or what has gone wrong for us in implementing the models, and why couldn't we succeed at the first try, and what are the mistakes that you could avoid. And obviously, I'm going to talk about some of our experiences, and then we'll probably have some time at the end for Q&A. I'm not going to go deep into any technique or platform because we don't have that time. Half an hour is not enough, but we can take that offline one-on-one after the talk. Okay, so first of all, when we say we are going to implement model or deploy a model, what does it mean, right? And what are the different components? So I put a simplified view of these could be the different components of model, and not that they do not exist. They already exist in most of the times, right? So there should be something in place for data collection and validation, which is already happening. Then we have to build something called feature extraction, meaning we're going to do some preparatory work, merge the data, summarize the data, create some features. And then there's called actually some scoring code. And that's what we're talking about, saying that's the model implementation part. But there are other parts to it, it has to integrate. And lastly, and sometimes we have found that is a problem, that once we implement the model, what are we going to do with those findings, right? What are your forecasts, what are prediction we are giving? I have seen some implementations fail because we have done it, everything is there. Now we are getting some referrals, but organization has no plan as to what to do with those output or how to utilize that output. And supported by that is saying this, there has to be, so one of the things that you need to think, some of these things are already there, but what you need probably is a second layer, which is saying you need some integration with those existing systems. Because when you build the model, typically you're building in an offline mode, you've dumped some data, but now you have to sort of refactor your code in, integrate with those systems from which the actual data is going to flow, the production data is going to come. In terms of feature extraction and scoring, we have to refactor some of the code, right? You may think I have built a model, especially with these newer techniques. What you do is when you build a model, you get a model object, right? Which may be a Java object or something. And it's very easy. You pass the new set of data and it gives you the result. So it's not like earlier times you get an equation you have to implement. So there is, in some way it is easy. But then you have to refactor the code in the sense that you have to make sure that you are getting similar data points, what you use for model building. So if you did any data transformations, you did any variable correction or anything, all of those have to be carried out. Any scaling, etc., that have been done, that has to be carried out. Otherwise, we found that's one of the first sources of why you don't get the correct output and what are the things that you need to. And that is not all. Once you have all this code, you have to monitor the results. And I would say at least in 50% cases, we have seen the first time we implement, the output that we get is not what we are looking for or not what we want. So you have to monitor the results. You have to see whether the implementation has gone right or not. Right? There's a lot of testing, etc., that you'll do. But still, once it starts to go actually in production, there has to be very close monitoring for first few days. And it's not enough. And sometimes you have to do what you have to do, a retrain. So once you have built a model, it's not a static model that's going to be running forever or forever. You have to take into account what's going to be the life of the model. Do you have to retrain it every 6 months, 1 year, 3 months? Or in some cases, we'll see there's dynamic retraining. There's retraining happening every day or with every new observation that's coming in. So when you do implementation, you have to take all of this cycle into account, saying, OK, integrate with the current systems, you know, refactor my current scoring codes, use those objects, and then you know, also monitor the results. And if needed, go back and retrain the model. Okay. Now, let's go a little bit you know, deeper into what we have. So what are the details? So we're going to only focus on the scoring and retraining. So I'm assuming that the integration part is going to be done. I'm not going to go into that portion. I'm saying, OK, what does it mean? Then we have to the scoring and retraining. What is the work involved in those things? Now again, what is the work involved and how do you structure it? Depends upon a few things, right? The first level of things is, what is the kind of inference? Inference means my prediction or my, you know, using the model to get the written. I want to do an inference in a batch or a real time. That will decide how complex my implementation is. So you should always back, you know? And obviously batch is much more easier than implementing real time. So if you don't really need real time, you don't know what to do with it, maybe it's good practice to start with a batch mode of prediction. So that way you can test that it's working in production well, right? The second could also be training. Training is one sort of models is the static models, meaning I have trained it once, now I don't really need to worry. Maybe it's 6 months, 1 year down the line, I don't worry about every day saying I'm going to have to retrain the model. Or there could be other scenarios in which you have to train it more frequently, or even dynamic training, meaning every time a new sort of something comes, I have to make sure that that gets integrated into the learning. Obviously, static is what we do. I think I would say 80-90% of the work we at least do, and most of the people here do, are static models, meaning you take the data somewhere, put in batch mode, you train the model, you're not training it every day or every time. But you could also have scenarios where you have to have a dynamic training or very frequent training. Maybe overnight training is required in certain scenarios. Okay. Obviously, when you have static training with batch mode inference, that's the simplest use case that I'm talking about, right? You do train your model once, and now you have to implement that model, and that also in batch mode, meaning you could literally take how you developed the model, because that's what how you do it in batch mode. You take overnightly batches or 6 hourly batches, or in some cases even weekly batches of data, and then you run it through the same process which is there. So obviously there is very little refactoring or, you know, rewriting of the code that is required. It's the easiest to implement. Some refactoring may still have to do, because even though it is batch mode, your data source may still change, right? Earlier, you were just reading from some CSV file, etc. But in a production environment, you don't really want that. So you may have to fetch some database, or, you know, the format may become different. So to that extent, you have to do some refactoring of the code. But it's typically not much. But we will see in some cases, you know, when we worked on these, even these use cases, we failed at the first instance. And I'm going to talk about what are the problems we encountered. Sometimes it feels very simple, right? I have a scenario, I have built the model, and I am just going to, you know, predict using new data. How difficult can it be? You know, when you go into production, sometimes, especially in a company environment, you could encounter a lot of issues, right? Obviously, the second level is that I have static training, but on-demand inference or real-time inference. Meaning it's not a batch that every night I get some new data and I inference, but every time there's an event happening, it could trigger, my model could be required to give a prediction. So it's, you know, dynamic or, on-demand inference or real-time inference, saying somebody's going to query, asks a new set of application will come, and immediately I need to assign something, right? So when I'm, for example, doing fraud detection online systems, or sometimes you even have credit decisioning online these days. Saying new data set of data will come, and immediately I need to take a decision what I need to do with that application or in an online environment. Obviously, these are much harder. There have to be many more considerations, you know, and significant refactoring of code. The code that I wrote that works on batch may not exactly work. So even if everything is the same, I mean, I use, let's say, Python to develop the model, and I'm using Python, some framework to score it, there still may be differences. And here again, you know, a lot of new libraries, new services have come out where you can take your model or the code, or, you know, along with the code that for transforming the variables and implement it as it is in production. Here you have to also worry about saying how many resources I'm going to have, what is going to be my inference time. I cannot have that, you know, new data comes and that can take like 10 minutes. So I have to really worry about my hardware resources, how fast am I turning it around. And here again, we have seen that when you actually go into production, you may even end up changing the model because you are not able to meet the inference time considerations. Otherwise, it's, you know, the inference is sort of useless. You have certain time within the inference has to be made. Okay. And the third one is, you know, most difficult to say, most common is dynamic training. So in dynamic training, you have to, you know, basically train also in automated fashion. When you do static training, you have a lot of control in terms of a person is there and he sees if the model that is coming out is good or not, or are there problems. But when you want to do dynamic training, you want to even do the model training in an automated fashion. And so you need to have a little bit, So complexity is much higher and you need a lot of online validations, right? So this is just high level. What are the different scenarios typically we face? If I look at composition today, still a lot of traditional companies will have a lot of it on the first side, meaning we can live with batch mode of inferencing and the models are static. The second one is, again, I think that component is getting more and more, saying we can have the static model, but then we need to have an inference which is on demand or near real time. So that it is useful. Otherwise, you know, if it takes too much time, then it does not work as well. Dynamic training, I think, still required only in very specific scenarios where you want to retrain, those off and off, almost in an automated fashion. But I would say the first component is going down. Second one is, use cases are going up. Third one will go up in future, not as strong today. Okay, let's say we have these scenarios, we have these things. So I'm just going to talk through saying what can go wrong. When we implement the model, it seems very simple, especially, and cover all the cases, saying what has, kind of things which have gone wrong, at least for us, and then we have learned and saying, now how do we avoid these things in future? Okay, so the first thing, let's say we have implemented the model, and this is one of the first things comes, we get no inference or target prediction, whatever. So we have a model which used to predict, let's say, fraud. First time we put it in production, all the probabilities are low, we don't get anything which is there. Now you don't know whether it's a problem with the model or it's the problem with how it is implemented, but this is the first sign of problem, saying, okay, everything is not as hunky-dory as I had thought, even if I use the same code. It has happened to us. And this also what happens is when you get this scenario, then it just, you don't know now when the implementation will happen, because obviously this thing cannot go on, right? So you may have to even go back to model building stage saying, okay, maybe I build the model in the wrong fashion. We have seen some of those scenarios. I was doing an implementation long ago, 10, 15 years ago, and we were doing an implementation. And the model used to work with fantastic accuracy when we were training it, 95%, 96%. We were predicting, whether a claim will come back for rework. Everybody was very happy. We went to the client saying, excellent results. Client said, okay, please implement. We implemented. And it was a batch run. Every night new claims used to come. We will say, okay, which ones will come for rework. First day implemented, nothing comes out. Meaning no claim will be rejected. Second day, nothing, no claim. So then client is saying, okay, what happened to all this? 90% accuracy, are these claims all are good? And in that scenario, when we went back and checked, we said that, the labeling of the data at the modeling stage itself was incorrect. And when we are actually doing in production, that, some of those things are, labeled or looked at by other people. Say, it can happen that when you implement, then only you need to know that my labeling was incorrect, or I built the wrong model. So no matter what I do, you can do anything, but it does not work in some of the other scenarios that we have experienced is that you didn't scale the variables, right? So we built the model, we did some pre-processing of the variables. Now that didn't get into the final implementation, and now we don't get anything. It happened in one of the image processing cases. We were doing some pre-processing, converting it from RGB to grayscale, and if we didn't do that, that's it. The model output will goes for a toss. So first thing is, we don't get anything output. Obviously, that's a big no-no. Other is we implemented something at times, and now client saying, okay, good, great, you have this implementation. Now, how do I know it is right or wrong? I hit image. And now we don't have an answer because it depends on what is that why, right? Sometimes it may take some time for you to know whether the prediction is right or wrong, right? In some cases, it is 1 month. Sometimes, some cases, you can, you're lucky, you can get it within, you know, 1 day or 2 day. You can, you know, work on it and say. In some other cases, you don't get to know for a long, long time. And I have seen cases where client says, okay, now it is there, but I need to test. See, on my, when I build, building the model, I was building on historical data, so I could test whether my prediction was right or wrong. And client is you know, happy now, saying, no, you tell me what is your accuracy in production. Saying, we can't tell you that now. You have to wait, you know, in certain credit scenario, you have to wait for almost a year to know whether the model in production is good or bad. So, and at some points, we have seen clients lose interest, saying, okay, now I don't know whether it is there or not. Maybe they do some one or two cases of audit and then say, okay, now it, you know, this one is wrong and, you know, I don't trust the output. So you have to be prepared for these scenarios, saying, how are you going to encounter these, or when you, if you, it's your model, you're going to encounter these things, you know, what do you, what are the things that you're going to look for? Is my model incorrect? Is my implementation incorrect? What is the scenario? Okay. We've also seen scenarios where we have implemented, done everything, but we don't know what to do now with that output. Okay, we said we're going to predict, you know, claims or whatever, but then now that some comes saying these claims, there's a problem with these claims, you need to have some operational support to verify whether that is correct or not, or to what to do with that output. If you do not have buy-in from the organization it's going to implement, then again implementation will fail. So after some time, planners will say, what is this useful? Nobody is using this output. Now again, when we are building the model, we do not sort of think about some of these issues. But these are some of the real issues that we have faced. Thing when we do it, you have to make sure that we, okay, I'm going to do this prediction. Who's going to use it? What? How are they going to use it? Is it integrated with their system? What all, you know, things it needs to be? Where does this output need to go? Otherwise, you know, it just remains like a, you know, pilot project we did and we never got any value out of it. And these are some, you know, real life cases that we have seen that this happens. Everything is there, and now, you know, I am suddenly saying, okay, what to do? Somebody said, did you implement? Oh, we implemented. Then what happened? Oh, we don't know. You know, it's somebody else's responsibility to now, you know, look at this referrals or output that we have created and use it. And if that party has not bought in, you know, it just goes for a toss. Okay. There's also scenarios with no prediction getting generated. These are some of the, I'm saying, extreme scenarios, but it is there. Happened very recently in all of our projects. You know, some of these newer libraries that we have, they have some features called saying if there is, for example, if you have categorical inputs in your data and you get a new category, then you don't know how to account for that input. And it may happen, saying I worked on something. And then in some of these systems, you have option to think, okay, when you, when that happens, do you error it out? Do you skip that? Do you not consider that? Or, you know, what do you do with that? And it, some setting was there that you skip that. And we were doing prediction and nothing is coming out at the other end because everything is getting skipped. And then it's, you know, we don't know, you know, it's some setting somewhere in the whole data pipeline saying you skip if there is an error. And then now some error happened because one field got mismatched or it's getting new values. And now everything is getting skipped. And it's completely, you know, no output is getting generated. You're putting in a lot of rows of data and no output is getting generated. And now, like, client is saying, okay, is your system working or not? So that is also a possible scenario. So you have to be prepared for saying, okay, when this happens, what are the things I'm going to look at? Go back and look at, think, this is happening. Okay. The last one is, you know, you have everything there. Prediction just takes too long to compute, right? We are doing an implementation, and the first pass when we did, it used to take half an hour to get all the prediction because the way the code was written, we were reading so many things, they needed historical data, we were going and getting that. And then, you know, it just didn't work with the client because you didn't get a backlog. So you have to also know what is going to be the inference time, you know, and some of these considerations may actually override the model accuracy. And I'll discuss a few scenarios saying how, when these things happen, you may have to go back and change stuff in model. So one client where we were implementing, inference time was too high, it was an online system, and they said, okay, sorry, we cannot compute all of these variables in production now. It's good that you created all of these great variables and improved my accuracy from whatever 94 to 96%, but you know, I'm sorry, you know, the the inference time is just too much. You have to only run it with 20, 25 variables. Just, you know. So now you have to go back. After running, the no fault of yours, you know, in your enthusiasm, you have created a lot of variables, and then, so if you did not check whether it is easy to implement them in production, sometimes we have even checked. That time, client will say, yeah, yeah, I can implement anything that you come. I need the best model. But when they actually run it in production, and then they may tell you, no, sorry, you know, their IT team or somebody will say, no, no, if you have this, then you know, we will not. It's not acceptable response time. Then you may have to go and actually change the model. And we have done that in some cases, saying, okay, now we created these 1,000 variables. We put all of them in machine learning models. And that's one of the things. In machine learning models, now we can put thousands of variables. Right? There's no, at the model building stage, you don't really need to be very careful about variable selection. Variable selection happens inside some of these algorithms. So what you end up is with a very fat model. And then when you go to production, it gets rejected. And then you, if you don't take care of that, so now we become wiser, we say, okay, at time of production, we double check, triple check, saying this is there, and only try to add a variable if it adds a significant value. Otherwise, it's going to slow you down in production and divide it on some values. Right? So these are some of the obvious cases. Then the big thing is, you have implemented everything, but invariably the prediction accuracy or whatever in model development what you had, you cannot replicate that in, get that in production. And that is a big, big point of failure. People get disillusioned. That's how ML projects fail. Not because we could not build a good model. You built a good model, but when actually implemented, you just do not see that kind of accuracy. And it can, and it is, it can be for a lot of different things, and then you have to worry about those things. Some of these are modeling aspects. Saying, okay, I had 95% accuracy, and I go to actual prediction, you know, I don't get anything above 50%. It could be because of mislabeling when we were actually building the model. It could be because input distributions or something has changed in the model and we have failed to account, or changed the environment and we have failed to account for that. Sometimes because of implementation, and sometimes things change. Let's say it was a fraud, you started some kind of patterns and you started catching those frauds, and that may itself trigger saying now the model performance will degrade. So you have to be aware, saying, is it degrading because there's something wrong in my implementation, or is it degrading because the input environment has changed? And how do I, so you need to have those reports to say, okay, has the input distribution changed for all of these variables that I'm using in model, or at least the top variables in the, if you don't have that, then it's a, okay, new process, systemic changes. Because we wanted to implement, we changed something in the process flow. And that can make your model go bust. Sometimes the implementation process itself, everybody very excited saying this is the new thing, we have to do this, okay. Obviously the other parts are underfitted, overfitted model. I used some sample data, it worked very well. Incorrect implementations could be there. I think I've already talked about some of the experiences. And I will talk about some of the experiences. So you see, there are a lot of new systems now. You can do a one-click implementation. You have projects like MLflow, where you can build the model, save that environment, do something else. You can spin up your own, if it's a Python model, or Python code model, you can spin up your own server and call it via API, or AWS or Azure. They're going to provide you with APIs, saying, you just give us the model, we're going to take care of API production. So I'm going to talk about cases where you don't do this. A lot of companies still saying, oh no, I don't want to go to cloud. My data is very important. I am going to do it all myself. So these are some of the cases, that things that we have seen. You're saying, we're working with an Indian client, and it's a big multinational, it's a big group. And we used Keras, we built forecasting. And we built model using the latest libraries, Keras, and we used deep learning and everything. And when we went into production, they're saying, oh sorry, in my production, for 1 month they struggled and they couldn't load, install Keras. Why? Because they were using an older operating system. So you see, Keras and all these libraries, they've come in the last 3-4 years. Now, a lot of companies are still using very old version of OS. So in that case, they're using CentOS and version 5, which is like end of their life. Now, it does not have some C libraries implemented, so you cannot implement Keras. But these things you don't. When you're building the model, we use the latest OS, and then the IT department refused, saying, no, we cannot update this OS. This is, the next version is not yet stable. We have these policies, etc. We have to go through this change. He said, can you help us? We said, we can't do anything. He said, can you help us, do stuff with that? We spent 1 month with the client, struggled, saying, okay, can he somehow, without upgrading OS, can we implement this? And we failed. And after 1 month, client all said, okay, fine, I understand now, I have to update OS. But it can trip, so simple things like that can trip you. You think implementing Keras is one line of code, right? Pip install Keras. But when it doesn't work, and especially production environments, clients are very finicky about making any changes. For your pilot, they can tell, say, okay, go do something else. But so one thing we have learned is now we also ask, saying in production, what kind of OS, etc. you are running, and are you willing to upgrade? Another example, we went to another client. They said, we only use Python 2 in production. We do not use Python 3. Why? Because Python 3 uses multi-cores and it blocks all the cores, and it's and then they said, we will not use Python 3. So you have to use Python 3 or compatible libraries only. Okay, so those kind of things. This hardware, it'll take me 6 months to procure the hardware, right? Everything is done, you have not lined that up, it is going to talk. Nobody wants to touch production, all of those things are there, right? Okay, so that's about it. Questions? You can take questions. Yeah. Okay. Yeah, you will go next. Yeah. Yeah, I can take that offline because that's not related directly to the topic. Sorry. Yeah.
Hi, sir. It was a good talk. Thank you. Yeah,
thank you.
I have two questions.
Yeah.
Which tool is your favorite one for building predictive models?
Okay.
And second question is, which tool do you suggest for a banking clients?
Right.
For building such models.
For building models, obviously, I think you use, you know, I think Python is a tool of choice because a lot of the algorithms, even if the algorithms are not in Python, you will have a wrapper on that. So our favorite tool is we use Spark for data manipulation and Python for building models. If the modeling technique is available in Spark, we may use even Spark. For packaging these models, you should look at MLflow. So if you use MLflow, either Spark or Python models, you can actually save the environment. So it'll save everything, all libraries that are there, and then you can directly transfer it to production. Or my other suggestion, if you can afford, there are a lot of excellent services, API services with AWS or Azure or some of these things. If you don't have that much technical bandwidth, then you should use those. And you can implement it very, very quickly.
Okay, thank you, sir.
If we are doing a dynamic training,
yeah,
how do I validate my output, or what is the best way to validate my output because I might be having my real outcome or not?
Yeah, excellent question. So his question is saying, in dynamic validation, the issue is that I don't want to have any human interference in order to, because it's going to happen every day. I don't want to have a person sitting, right, when you're doing static implementation. So I need to be able to, first, there has to be some stop rules to say, you know, if my prediction just goes wild, you know, there has to be some human being who has to, there has to be some, you know, otherwise it can lead to very large losses. So there has to be some monitoring, there has to be some, you know, I think the best way is saying there's some strategic stop loss rules, saying if this happens, then no matter what, you know, it has to trigger some kind of alarm, you stop the system or you go on to a backup, meaning don't predict. But it's not always that a loss has to be catastrophic or what, right? And then you need to have next set of, you know, either machine learning driven rules or machine learning, you know, monitoring. Monitoring in the terms of your could be just monitoring one out of pattern. Saying suddenly I start getting a lot of certain things. Then it has to trigger an alarm. So have rules to, you know, for catastrophic situations, and then have models on top of that to monitor. Saying is my output going out of pattern or not. Yeah, so it could be very simple. So saying I'm predicting something and I say, oh, in the last whatever 1 hour, whatever, I should not get more than X number of predictions of fraud, or I should not go lower than this, saying nothing is being effort. So I have to define those tolerances.
These are the business
tools I will be using. You can use strategic rules. You can also use threshold is rules. So, I mean, you define the rules. One other thing is you can have the threshold be determined dynamically, or you have like one class SVM where you are just detecting out of pattern anomaly detection. time series anomaly detection is what you can use to say whether something is going off from this.
So let's say my model is exposed.
Yeah.
On my output, I can use this SVM.
Yeah. First, yes. On the output, you use one class SVM, or you can use any of the anomaly detection tools. Right? Yeah. So, yeah.
Thank you, sir. It was a good talk. my question is, ML implementation also includes the continuous learning pipeline after deploying the model, you get the results.
So that's why I said, training is continuous or is it static model? Best practice is that it should be refreshed. Now, how often should be refreshed is the question.
Correct.
And whether you need human interference in that refresh.
So my first question is, what is the best practice for that continuous training of the model, and what kind of tools do you use for that pipeline building of continuous learning?
Excellent question. So best practice is obviously to do it, as soon as it degrades. So for that you have to monitor. So you can set some thresholds saying whether the model performance is, how's the model performance. You can also have some rules on the input and output, saying is my score distribution varying too much, what is the output? Then also I'll take a look. So there can be different thresholds saying this is take a look, this is stop the model, go to some backup plan. Third is, don't do anything. Everything is, system is running. When you have to retrain it, you have to use what is called incremental learning techniques. So when you want to do fast retraining, you cannot retrain on the whole entire set data and the new data, right? But thankfully, most of these cases, you can do an incremental training. Meaning you can run new iterations, your old weights are still there, you only vary those weights with the new iterations, with the new observations that are coming in. So you have to be very careful when you're retraining. You have to retrain when you have, enough. You need to know what is the right or wrong before retraining, right? So that period has to have passed.
How do we make that decision on whether it is right or wrong, whether it's the right time to retrain?
Yeah. So one is you have to watch the output and see. See, one is if your accuracy time is very small, meaning you can determine whether it's good or not, you go with accuracy of the model or what is out, where your predicted variable. But sometimes, let's say that is period is very large, then you watch the distribution of output. Whether you don't know whether it's correct or not, but at least the distribution, is it like what has happened in past? Third is you watch the input distributions, have they changed or not. And then you decide when to retrain. In certain scenarios, you will retrain every day anyway, irrespective, because the patterns are changing so fast.
So
this one, okay, I'll come back to you. Yeah. Or you can just shout the question.
So in the earlier part of your presentation, you mentioned how the data set that you use for your training actually tripped you because whatever you had in production was just not matching up.
Right.
So as an organization, what are you doing now to ensure that the data set that you're using for your training is actually going to match up with the accuracy that you need during production?
Yeah. See, if your client is certifying that is correct, there's very little that you can do. Sometimes that...
Data set.
I'm talking about data set only. So what happened in that set? So we had data set, right? It is the labeling of the data set, that what is why. So what is a... So in that case, there were claims. And then we asked the operations team to say, okay, which claims are rework claims, which claims are not rework claim. And that process was not rigorously followed. So as a... organization, what we are now doing is saying, once we get those labeled back, we replay it back to the client, saying this is the level of inaccuracy or this is the level of rework that we are getting. Is this in line with what you think it should be, or is it
during training,
when we get the labeled data back from the client, we replay it back and say, okay, is this in line with your expectations or not? And then after that, you have to assume that client has done their job, or whoever is supposed to have done their job well. See, that is a different topic, saying how you generate label data. If your labeling is not correct, then obviously everything goes for a toss, that example. So you have to, that is, I would say, more than production. We got to know because of production, but it is more of a modeling task, that you have to verify that the data that you're building model on is correct and makes sense. So you do your regular validations, you replay it back to the client saying, I'm getting 0.5% default or 2% default, 5% default, and then is that wrong, or some of the factors that are coming out there. That's a different topic. I mean, it's not related to any of the model. I'll come back to it.
So how do hardware platforms play a role here? Because we have different hardware accelerators now.
Right.
During the ML model implementation and deployment, what is the trend that you have seen?
Yeah, so that's a great question. I don't know if I'll be able to do full justice, because hardware accelerator, or choice of hardware is again will dictate your inference time and what kind of things you can do with the model. So standard is you use, it depends on what technique you're using, right? So obviously you'll use CPU, you'll use certain kind of accelerator, you can cache certain data. Or if it is more intensive problem, you use GPUs or you use TPUs for implementation. No, so my thing is you can do it, go to cloud, because there you will get much better scalability. Experts will take care of that. If you try to do it yourself, it will be troublesome. It's not easy. It's not trivial.